Hello and welcome to the first episode of the worst podcast of all time, where we talk all things bad movies, new and old. I'm Andrew Ryan, and this is my co-host Spencer Carlson.
What's up?
Spencer, before we get into this week's episode, the first episode, which is Catwoman, which, as we'll talk about, is one of the worst movies, if not maybe the worst movie I've ever seen. I had no idea. Like, I had seen it before. And we'll get into that. I'm going to start by talking about what I've been watching that isn't complete garbage.
All right.
So, as you may know, Nicholas Winding Refn, or whatever, the director of Drive, released a new movie recently called The Neon Demon, starring my future wife, Ella, or Elle Fanning. I don't know how to pronounce any names. So
your future wife that you don't know.
Who I fell in love with in 2011 with Super 8. And we grew up together. We're the same age.
Okay.
So we're going to be married. Because that's really all that matters is that I think we're the same age.
I do think that step one would be figuring out how to pronounce her name.
Yeah.
That, you know.
Because really, I mean, that's typically the only thing separating me from marrying celebrities is the age gap. That's it.
And, well, and the name pronunciation, but...
No. So, for a little research, you know, just so I wasn't completely underprepared, because it is playing at the movie theater that I work at, or it was, not a lot of people came to see it because they're stupid.
Gotcha.
I watched a few of his movies. So I started with Drive, which is his most popular, and I thought that was fantastic. Ryan Gosling's incredible, and I want to be him. And then, right after that, I watched... right at the day after that, I watched Bronson, which was like a polar opposite kind of performance from Tom Hardy as Ryan Gosling, but another amazing one. And really, that was the best part of the film, was Tom Hardy's performance, and it's really hinged on it. The movie was a little weird, and you know they're all weird.
Yep,
I'd say Drive is probably his like most widely appealed one, like.
Like so the least,
the most accessible for most people.
Gotcha. What year was Drive?
That was 2011.
Okay.
Bronson was 2008, which surprised me because I did not know Tom Hardy's really big in the movie, and I didn't know he was that big because in Inception he doesn't look that big. But then I know he put on a lot of muscle in 2012 for The Dark Knight Rises.
Oh yeah. I completely forgot that Tom Hardy was even in Inception. I like the line where he pulls out the grenade launcher and says something witty, but I don't know what the line is.
You've got to mustn't try be it. Afraid to dream a little bigger,
that's,
darling.
That's what it is.
No.
Yeah, I got to love Tom Hardy.
Anyway. And then right after that, I watched Only God Forgives, which are probably his three most popular movies, excluding The Neon Demon. Mm-hmm. And Only God Forgives, I mean, it's, you know, it's got his, like, weird style, and he's very visual. And I just found out he's part colorblind. So he makes his movies really colorful so that like he can tell the difference. And I thought that was really interesting. And they are really colorful.
That's really interesting.
Yeah. And Only God Forgives was it was a little too weird for me. I didn't think it had much going for it. A lot of people say it's style over substance. People who say they like it usually say that people just didn't get it. And I'm okay with not getting a movie. I'm not going to pretend to like a movie because pretentious people say they like it.
Yeah.
Even though I am pretty pretentious. So then after that, I watched The Neon Demon, and I thought it was very good. It was very bizarrely erotic.
Bizarrely erotic.
Because, you know, I'm going to marry Elle Fanning.
Oh, yeah. And
she is the main character.
Gotcha.
And I'm also making a time travel movie, so I was watching some movies to get some inspiration for that. I rewatched Primer, which is a great movie. Great low-budget movie. And speaking of Primer...
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the extent to which that is a low-budget film is just incredible.
And speaking of Primer, which is a 2007?
Four.
2004 science thriller about time travel and, like, parallel universes, is that right? I haven't seen the film.
Yeah, they pretty much accidentally create a time machine, and then it just gets way out of hand with all the doubles and alternate...
Yeah.
Timelines, and it gets really confusing, but I think it's incredibly well made.
It's one of those movies that I just gotta see.
It was shot entirely on used film stock. I've just found that out.
Wait,
which
really?
I didn't understand. I don't know much about literal film, because I've always, we've grown up in the digital age of film. I didn't realize that you could reuse film, but you just bleach it and reshoot on it. It loses quality every time you do it, but I didn't realize that.
Hmm.
And since they only had so much film, they just did so much rehearsals, and every scene is the first take. And speaking of Primer, that director, 9 years later, finally released a very anticipated movie. Anticipated just because of his last movie.
Yeah.
Called Upstream Color, which I just watched.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I heard about that.
And it's so weird. I felt like it was a little too weird, but, like, so much, I really don't know how to feel about it. I definitely liked it. Liked it. I actually, just last night, watched Swiss Army Man, which was hilarious and incredible and heartwarming. And
one of those movies that, for me, when I watch the trailer, I just look at it and I'm like, this looks almost, I think, maybe too weird. It looks like one of those movies that might take like one too many artistic liberties, but like
it's like a perfect blend of unbelievable, what's happening. You're like, what? Yeah. And then also like profoundly real.
Yeah. So yeah, obviously I haven't seen it yet. Because
he's crazy. So Daniel Radcliffe, who's dead, starts talking.
Yeah.
And he thinks he's like bringing him back to life slowly with love. And then he's basically teaching him about life as if he's like just born again. And the things they talk about, like it's like in a comedic way, but it just gets so real. And like Daniel Radcliffe's asking these questions about society and you're just like,
yeah.
I mean, it's like funny. Like it's not supposed to be like this philosophical thing. It just kind of catches you off guard.
Like, that was the part that like,
and I loved the soundtrack. It's so like meta, like the lyrics in one of them is like montage. It's like, you can like barely hear it. Popcorn. Wait, what is it? How does it go? Popcorn. I don't remember. Oh gosh. They start singing and then it like, it's like one of those things where like, it will cut away from them doing sound effects, but like the sound effects will keep going and it builds and builds.
Yeah.
You know, they're like making sound effects with their mouth.
I wasn't sure if it was going to be like trying to be both very inspirational and very funny at the same time.
Yeah.
Which in a lot of cases can result in just being like awkwardly funny and just kind of weird.
And it feels like two movies sewn together.
Super weird, like two different types of plots like mashed together, but like, I mean, based on what you're telling me, it sounds pretty
good. Speaking of two movies sewn together, I watch a lot of movies, guys. I watch at least, like, almost at least one movie every single day. I watched Full Metal Jacket, which I thought was very, very good, but it does feel a lot like two movies sewn together, with the first half being the better one and the more iconic one. Like, everything from the second half, I had never seen anything of. Like, every clip I had seen and every quote is from the first half. Which is with the drill sergeant, with, you know, the hilarious, famous drill sergeant. You know what I'm talking about?
No.
The, what is your major malfunction? Numbnuts, you know, like that guy. And he's like, I will screw off your head and piss down your throat. Like,
oh, yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah.
He's just completely unscripted. Like, it's hilarious. Yeah, it was the first time I watched it. But the reason I brought up Swiss Army Man so quickly after Primer and Upstream Color is because the director, writer, producer, editor, composer of Primer and Upstream Color, Shane Carruth, which is a very talented guy, very smart, talented guy, who actually went to Stephen F. Austin College.
Yeah.
Which is pretty cool because we live in Austin. He actually is in Swiss Army Man as like a forensic scientist. Like,
oh, okay.
He's in it like for like maybe 20 seconds and I hear his voice and I just watch Upstream Color and I'm like, and he's sort of in the distance. Yeah. I'm like, is that Shane Carruth? And then it is. And I was like, that's obviously like just a cool cameo. Cause he hasn't starred in a lot of, I think he's been in one other movie, that he didn't direct. Like he doesn't do it a lot.
Yeah. What is he do on a normal day?
I got really excited and
that's so cool.
I thought it's like near the end. It's not really a spoiler, but yeah. So be on the lookout for Shane Carruth, talented guy. I think we should talk about our favorite movies, like together, not our personal favorite movies, but our together favorite movies.
yeah, that was great.
Yeah, thanks.
Let's keep that line right in there.
Okay, yeah. Your favorite film, I believe, is Memento.
That's correct.
And that is easily in my top five.
Yeah.
We love that film. Everyone should love that film. It's so good. It's really just a... It's... Yeah.
Oh, gosh.
Let's see. What else? Whiplash.
Dark Knight.
The Dark Knight. Right. I didn't realize you liked that as much as... That's my favorite
film. Oh, yeah. I love that movie. Yeah. That's in my top five, I think. Maybe, oh, man. Maybe top 10.
It's so good. Yeah. Heath Ledger. Miss you.
Truman Show. I don't know if this is in your top movies, but...
No.
I really...
Top 100, maybe.
I watched it, like, the first time I watched it, and it kind of, like... I don't even know why it, like, just hit me so incredibly hard.
Yeah.
Like, more than almost any movie had before.
Everything he says is so true, man. Show.
Yeah, you ruined... Okay, so I hate the
you hate the movie now. Yeah.
Ruined everything.
Good. Wait, were you watching anything? Did you think of anything?
No, I didn't think of anything for what I was watching, but next episode, that we'll do that segment in its entirety.
Hey, props to Spencer for
getting real prepared for this. Yeah.
I was actually not going to be sarcastic. I was going to say for like getting all the equipment and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
While I do all the actual content.
Yeah.
So I got some bad news for you, Spencer.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
Lay it on me.
Mel Gibson is developing a Passion of the Christ sequel.
All right.
Now, I have not seen Passion of the Christ. By all accounts, it is very preachy and just torture porn for religious people. Christians, I should say. Mm-hmm. And also, aside from the fact that it's a pretty... middling movie. My religious coworker pointed out to me when I told him that doesn't make any sense. The fact that there's a sequel, unless it's like a prequel, which we already got a movie called The Young Messiah this year.
It really doesn't make Easter. A whole lot of sense at all. That was the first thing that came to mind.
Because he comes back. And it's like, what? But yeah, so it'd be like a sequel of one of the disciples or something. A disciquel. You could say.
Great.
Yeah. This is the worst podcast of all time. It's the worst. I'm just trying to
fit the bill for the worst.
I love puns, by the way, so you're going to get lots of that. All right. Let's just move on to the next thing, because I do have a lot of news since this is the first week. Because every episode from now on, I will only have in between the two recording dates. But this I had, you know, as much time as I wanted.
Definitely.
Now, did you know that there was going to be a Tetris movie?
Yes, I had heard about it.
Okay.
And I blocked it out of my memory as soon as I
blocked.
Could.
Blocked.
Yeah.
You blocked. Block.
Okay.
Tetris
I'm
block.
I'm shutting down the podcast. We're done recording.
Tetris movie. The Tetris movie. Now, you thought it was going to be a movie. Well, get ready, Spencer, because it's going to be a trilogy.
What?
Oh, gosh. Okay, okay.
Does this ever happen? Do they plan trilogy?
Filmed consecutively. Like The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings. That is such a big risk. That is such a big risk. The Lord of the Rings trilogy is one of the most, like, influential, famous, like, book series of all time. Like, you're relying on that, like, when you do that. Tetris is a game. Like, you cannot depend on people going to see Tetris, an old game, a Tetris me. And, okay, the producer says...
Is it going to be about, like, the production of Tetris, or is
no,
it going to be
no,
a
no.
world
I don't, inside? I don't know. Okay, the producer says, quote, "It will be not at all what you think. It will be a cool surprise."
Oh.
Yeah. Okay,
maybe
and,
shouldn't
he,
be
and
bad
he said,
news.
"This isn't like us trying to get money. This here, let me get my producer voice. This isn't us trying to get like a bunch of money, like this." Because this is his double chin,
uh-huh.
like
cutting,
choking,
cutting into his vocal cords.
Right,
gotcha.
Exactly. Gotcha. Yeah, because they're all fat cats, literally. Like with, and he's like, "This isn't us trying to get a bunch of money, because that's not the point of my job. Of course not.
No.
It's just the story won't fit into one thing. And that baffles me, that they can't make up a story. Like, if you have a source material and you can't fit that into one movie, that makes sense. They are making up the story and they can't fit it into one. You're obviously just trying to extend it.
It's trying to, like when you have...
There is no story to Tetris. I wonder if it's going to be, like, Sausage Fest? Sausage Party. Yeah. Where it's, like... They think they're having fun, but then once they get in a line, they disappear and die, and it's horribly violent. So then they're all, like, falling to their death the whole movie.
Yeah, but
there's only one setting, right? I mean, how... Is it going to be, like... Big or what's the movie? Wreck-It Ralph, where it's like a bunch of video game characters.
Oh, it's so stupid. Everything you're saying, like you're giving examples of like objectively, like oh, that was kind of a good idea, right? But like, how could Tetris, which as we're speaking, is just a game about blocks, and Wreck-It Ralph has already happened, so
which you blocked out from your memory.
Great, thank you. Thank you for bringing that back. We already have a movie about video game characters coming into other video games, so that can't be possible. That can't be another thing that happens. For a trilogy.
Filmed consecutively. Speaking of film consecutively, I know I've told you before, and this is sort of old news.
Yeah.
But I recently found out more details on it, that there will not be three more Avatar movies, but there will be four, right? I told you that, which makes a total of five Avatar movies.
I'm sorry.
That was, I put that on one of the film club presentations. I was the president of the high school film club.
I'm not sure if I remember that because...
You might have not been there since
because
you're
excuse
a
me?
Piece of shit.
There are
four, James Cameron is making four sequels to the culturally insignificant Avatar, which no one cares about anymore. No one cares about. Remember how Sam Worthington was in everything after that movie? Like, even his career has died since then.
I need to understand this real quick. So, we have one movie.
Spencer, we can't talk. Like, everyone knows this. Like,
I don't know this.
Okay.
Avatar, 2009, right?
2009.
2009, 7 years ago.
$2 billion
so
worldwide.
Far has... There's one movie right now that exists.
And James Cameron... Hang on. You're not getting this. He will be filming four sequels. Not consecutively. Not consecutively, but at the same time. What? Right. He's going to put all four stories, okay.
What?
So if there's a location in Avatar 5 that's also in Avatar 3, they're going to film them at the same time. Like, they're filming it as if it's one long story.
God.
Like, which I guess is the cheaper version of that. And I
but
don't,
what?
Like, this really, like, proves to me. It does. Okay, it doesn't prove. But to me, this totally says that the producers have no idea what they're doing. Like, they clearly have no idea what the people like. Like, no one cares about this movie.
Yeah.
No one cares about this movie anymore.
And
they think, well, it made a lot of money, so it will make a lot of money again. Like, they have no idea about timing or anything.
Haven't we been proven, like, time and again that that's not the case? Like, if movie one made X amount of money, like... Haven't we been, like, hasn't the general public just been shown before, like, that doesn't happen?
It's not even that, like, I feel, I'm obviously, I have no credibility on the matter, but I feel like...
let's keep talking about it.
I feel like it's not so much that they're like, hey, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, oh, which, by the way, I watched that and it was god-awful. I walked out after 40 minutes.
Yeah, more on that later.
Oh, I don't think it's so much that, like, they're like, hey, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles made a lot of money. Let's make another one. I think it's like, hey, you want to make a movie? How do we know it'll make money? We don't. Oh, well, this did make money. Like, it's just that they feel so safe doing it. It's not so much they're like
okay,
this is a good opportunity.
Right.
They just feel more comfortable, like, doing something that has already shown that people will come see.
So what you're saying is, like, they don't...
That's just my theory.
They don't think that, like... Or they might think, but they're not 100% sure that it's going to make more, but they're just hoping that it's going to make money.
It's just a safe bet with sequels. Like, this, there are so many sequels this summer.
Yeah.
Alice in Wonderland, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Independence Day.
All of which, by the way, Conjuring has been negatively panned.
Conjuring 2 was good.
Never mind.
First one was I'd probably better, but Conjuring 2, I think James Wan's the best horror director right now. The best mainstream horror director.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? Let's move on. I don't like this. Live action Clifford the Big Red Dog movie is in development.
Why? Why? What happens with these?
Oh my gosh.
I want to know.
Isn't there a Louis C.K. thing about Clifford? Doesn't he talk?
Yeah.
We're big fans of Louis C.K.
I don't know. Was it Louis? No. I know.
Well, he was in a stand-up. And he's like, it's just a dog. Like, why? They made him big. Yeah. Yeah, that's what
Louis C.K.
They just drew him big. He's like, there's no point. Do you read cracked articles?
Yes.
So I just recently reread an old article about five reasons Hollywood movies suck, and it's really interesting. He talks about for example, original scripts are basically just used to prove that screenwriters can write, and then they get assigned to something. And also, so many movies, and they'll take so many original scripts and then modify them to be sequels. Like all the Die Hard sequels were originally just original films that they rewrote to be Die Hard sequels. Like I, Robot was a film by itself, but then no one would come see it if they didn't attach a really popular sci-fi book title to it. And that's why it's nothing like the book. It's a very philosophical book. And then the movie's just this generic action movie.
Okay, so you're saying they have a script that is...
Yeah, they have a script, and then they'll change it.
At the time, it's either nameless or has a different name, right?
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly.
And then they're like, we have a book called
Robot. Hey, you know, this is sort of similar to something that people know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that why... Is that the reason why that we have so many movies that are... That, like, people like... Is that the reason that the whole... problem with books becoming movies, is that?
No, I don't think that's the case for all books becoming movies.
Yeah, I don't think so either. But I'm sure it's for some. But
obviously for iRobot.
Yeah,
as we just said.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, this is good. Universal is being sued for sending out spam texts without permission. This is the text.
What?
Hello from the Warcraft movie team. You are one of the chosen few invited to join the fight today. Will you lead the Horde or Alliance to victory? Sent that out to people. And some guy's suing them because he did not give them permission. I mean, I'm assuming a bunch of people got it without giving them permission. But then this one guy clearly knows that that's illegal. And I think that's hilarious. Warcraft.
That's so weird.
By all accounts, is a shit movie.
Yeah, it looked really bad.
Do you have any thoughts on that? I mean, I just think that's hilarious.
I don't know. It just seems like something...
No one came to see Warcraft in America.
I don't know. It just seems like the whole texting
thing... 90, I think, percent of its grossing is foreign, overseas. That's incredible.
Really?
Right? Yeah. Usually it's less than 50, I think. I don't know. But 90, that's insane. It does really... That's another reason. On the Cracked article is that so many action movies have to be they can't study North American life. It won't go good with universally everyone understands that you have to run away from big robots.
That's so weird.
Okay, on to some more topical stuff. Roland Emmerich or Emmerich, do you know who that is?
No.
That is pan director of Independence Day, 2012, Day After Tomorrow. Just countless.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the 98 Godzilla movie, I think.
What? He did that?
I think so.
We're going to look that up real quick.
Godzilla.
Did he, if he did that?
98. Hold on. It's loading. This is, Roland Emmerich. Gosh, wow. he's just a terrible director, I think the Independence Day is fine. The first one.
Mm-hmm.
All the other movies are bad. Or, like, I'll just say that.
He just likes to make like really
Anyway, he's been in the news quite a bit recently with his new movie, and he's kind of known for just like being like thinking that he's like really cool. Like
yeah.
He said that Steven Spielberg told him when Independence Day came out that everyone would copy that movie. And he was like, and he was the smartest guy ever because they're right and everyone's been copying it with all the city destruction. It's like, you didn't invent natural disasters, man. Anyway.
Yeah.
So he criticized Marvel movies, saying, quote, when you look at... I don't know what his voice is. I'm going to... When you look at my movies, that's it's exactly always it. The regular Joe Schmo that's the unlikely hero. A lot of Marvel movies, they show people in funny suits running around. I don't like people in capes. I find it silly when someone dons a superhero suit and flies. I don't understand it. I grew up in Germany. Oh, what's a German accent? I grew up in Germany.
This is the part.
I don't even know.
The part where you get racist.
I probably grew up in Germany. No, he didn't probably. He did.
He did.
I grew up in Germany. That's probably why. Says he doesn't like sequels.
I don't know.
This is already silly. He says this after Independence Day 2 comes out.
Mm-hmm. Good.
With Independence Day resurgence coming out in sequels, director Roland Emmerich says, I don't like sequels. Did I say coming out in sequels? I meant to say theaters. Let me say that again. It's not worth it. Independence Day resurgence sets up a sequel, by the way, and so another one, and he doesn't like them. And he says it'll be intergalactic. I haven't seen the movie, but apparently it's like clearly sets up another one at the end.
Oh, great.
Another one. Yeah.
No.
Now, Spencer, you're my bud, right?
I'm your bud.
Okay. Well, Bud Spencer died at age 86, and he's like a actor, director.
I'm only laughing.
He did a lot of like Western pun, parody comedies. I've never seen any of his things, and I hadn't heard about him until he died. I just wanted to bring that up because you're my bud, Spencer. So let's just move on.
Can we redo
it's bad news. What?
Can we redo the part where I laugh at someone's death?
So I mean, Super Mario Bros. Director. Now, have you seen this movie? Super Mario Bros. The first video game film.
I have been avoiding it.
Yeah, we're going to watch it. What's eventually.
Not next episode. An episode in the future. It's going to be one of those.
A future episode, I think is the word. Not next episode. Maybe yeah. Next episode. I honestly, why not? We haven't chosen.
Yeah.
Super Mario Bros. Terrible. Director. Now, this is good news about a bad film. But it's also a bad film because it didn't happen. I mean, bad news because it didn't happen. He said he really wanted, for Mario... Danny DeVito.
I think you mentioned that, and that is the if he makes that, like wanted as in when he made it originally.
Yeah, but I think he turned it down.
Of course.
So he got the guy from Who Framed Roger Rabbit. I can't remember his name. Doesn't matter. Let's not look it up. Why would we?
Yeah, we only have like extreme technology. That's, I don't know what that means. You know,
we have technology.
Extreme
technology. Little SpongeBob quote for you.
We're very technologically advanced right here.
Like that's really funny. Like that doesn't make me mad like the rest of this news. Like it's about a bad film though.
What was the news? I wasn't listening.
He recently said like it hadn't. I don't think it had been.
Okay.
He says he really wanted Danny DeVito.
Yeah, that's not bad news at all. That's so. That would have made the movie, like. That might have been a cult film if that had happened. Like, it might have been one of those, like, so bad it's good films.
Well, we haven't seen the film. I hear it's just nothing like the game, though.
Yeah.
Okay. So, we love the Transformers movies.
I personally love them, and I've seen none of them.
Okay, so Transformers... somewhat recently released on Instagram a little video of like the title sequence, right?
Oh yeah, because there's another one coming out.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, of course.
Like, so it, you know, like how all the metal comes together and says Transformers, mm-hmm. right? So this one's called The Last Knight with a K. The Cast Knight. No, the Knight has a K, not last. So
did you write that down?
No.
Dang it.
The Last Knight... and then in the title sequence, a sword goes through the middle, like down.
Great.
Through the middle of the does it stab the text.
Does it stab the text?
Yes.
Make a big
or behind it. I don't know.
Sound?
Yeah, little sparks and disgusting grease like Michael Bay.
Great.
God. I mean, Michael Bay with an E. Bay E.
B-A-E. B-A-E. Yeah. Michael Bay.
Superb.
Oh, we should do a shout out.
Please, good shout out to Superb on Letterboxd.com. We'll talk about that in a minute. Or later.
So well, let's just
you'll never hear about it ever again. This okay, so
forget it.
The plot rumors revealed. Okay, this is just speculation. You know, honestly, I haven't even checked.
Since I wrote this down.
The actual plot might have been released, but I'm just going to talk about the rumors. Because we have been trying to prepare this first episode for a while. So the film picks up where the previous movie left off with Optimus Prime in space. He returns to Cybertron to find the planet dead, which I'm sure is just going to look so ugly. Gross metal and this dark planet that has no atmosphere.
Yeah.
Whatever, it's not important. Returns to Cybertron to find the planet dead, and he learns he's the one to blame for it. To bring it back to life, he'll need a mysterious artifact that is on Earth. So he's going back to Earth. You know, everything's on Earth for some reason. Humans, those, like...
So, already...
Narcissistic.
Hold up. My first question is, like, why... Who cares?
Yeah. So the artifact is connected to Merlin, the sorcerer mentor to King Arthur in the legendary story.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah. No, I'm not. I'm sorry. I'm not kidding you.
Are you serious?
Remember, this is rumors.
Are they going to...
Now, Merlin gained his magic through a visiting Transformer. Okay? Now, this isn't the first time, like, in a Transformers movie that it's said that, like, human history has been influenced by Transformers, right? Remember? Have you seen any... You haven't seen any of them, right?
I've seen zero, and I'm happy.
Oh, gosh. I totally forgot about that.
Yeah.
Okay, well, like... I've seen the first three. I don't think there's anything about that in the third one, but definitely the first and second one, like ancient human history was influenced by Transformers. So here's another one, but this is just a legend. Anyway, so the artifact is connected to Merlin, right? The sorcerer of King Arthur. Merlin gained his magic through a visiting Transformer, which is a speculation that the artifact could be the mythical sword Excalibur, hence the sword featured in the film's title sequence.
What?
Yeah. So, I mean, just that's really all the plot rumors there is. And then Megatron returns again as the villain.
I thought, okay, so, like, when they made, like... It's just so silly. Every time that they make a new Transformers movie, they add another element. Like, I thought that was going to be done with, like, the dinosaurs, right? I thought it was like, oh, they're making a Transformers.
I can't believe how much money that fourth one made. I thought everyone hated it now. But no, they keep making money. And everyone's... It's because it looked like a sort of like semi-reboot with Mark, well, I got my inventions, you know?
Marky Mark.
Living in Texas.
It's just...
Okay, now this is bad news about a good movie. So, you and I... Huge Lego movie fans, right?
Oh, yeah.
Lego movie is a great movie.
Good movie.
It's being pushed back to 2019.
The sequel?
Yeah. No, the first one. They're going to re-release it.
They're going to re-release the first one.
They're going to erase everyone's memory. Sorry.
Of what?
Lego movie. Oh, you got me.
That was quick.
Oh, that was good. That was good.
It was a good one.
I'm proud of you, Spencer. Here, give me some. That was us shaking hands.
I'm gonna remove the past 20 minutes. So the sequel's being pushed back to 2019?
Yeah, Lego movie's a great movie. That's a shame. Okay, next news.
Are we done with bad news? You got some more? Get some more coming?
I have a few more.
All right, let's get going.
Okay, yeah. We really need to get into the movie.
I mean, I can cut out.
Okay, I'm gonna power through this, okay? DreamWorks will resurrect the Shrek films.
What?
Okay, that means that there's either going to be a sequel, a reboot, a remake.
Prequel.
The point is, there's going to be another Shrek film. Now, first Shrek is good. Second Shrek is good. Third one's terrible. Fourth one I never saw, but I hear it's
third
bad.
One, okay, when I watched the third one at the age of that I was of the third one, you know, coming out, I really liked it.
I thought it was fine,
you
even
know,
then.
Yeah, even then. But, you know, it's not good. But
that's the reason I say it is because half of them aren't very good.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and then there's Puss in Boots. And I don't know if that's good.
Yeah, it's actually really good.
Really?
Yeah, I saw that in theaters, actually.
Really?
In Alamo Drafthouse. Yeah, really. It's really good.
Huh, okay. Okay, so this is one of my least favorite movies of all time that we're going to be talking about. God's Not Dead.
Oh, good stuff.
So God's Not Dead producers facing $100 million copyright lawsuit. Okay?
Yeah.
And this is, the movie came out in 2014, so this is a few years later. Because, you know, that's American law for you, mm-hmm. I guess. I mean, that's really the only law I know. I don't know if it's better in different countries. Probably in looser countries. That's not the point. A screenwriter named Kelly Kohlberg says she developed a screenplay called Rise, which never made it into production. And she says that's because God's Not Dead, the God's Not Dead producers used her story.
Mm-hmm.
She's suing Pure Flix Entertainment and David A.R. White, which we're just going to call Mr. White, for copyright infringement. Quote, "The theme, setup, opportunity, turning point, change of plans, complications, setback, final push, climax, and aftermath of the of the Rise screenplay and the God's Not Dead motion picture are the same." So that's kind of hard to
go
around.
Yeah.
First, she described her story to Woody White. Ooh, another White. So we'll call him Sir White. The president of a faith-based group at Harvard, hoping he might invest in the project. Then, according to the lawsuit, Sir White was... I was trying to figure out which White this was.
Yeah.
Sir White was so excited about Rise that he passed the information on to Ted Baer, who we'll call Yogi. Chairman of the Christian Film... chairman of the Christian Film and Television Commission.
Mm-hmm.
Next, Yogi discussed the plot with God's Not Dead actor-producer Mr. White at the time when PureFlix was working on... when PureFlix was working to develop a Christian apologetics project but struggling to conceive a story. The film and Kohlberg's story... Kohlberg, the original writer of Rise, right?
Yep.
In case you got confused with all the names.
Yeah.
The film and Kohlberg's story both depict, quote, it's like exactly the same. A young college student who has to confront a popular and charming atheist professor in three debates, who struggles in the first debate, but succeeds in the next two after encouragement from supporting characters, including an unmarried local pastor, a rural married couple, who in God's Not Dead is played by Duck Dynasty and some other person who can't act, one of the members of Duck Dynasty.
Really good stuff right here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The atheist professor's wife, who is also a professor's former student, and an international student ally, and manages to persuade many others, including the professor, that God does exist. So
what it sounds like is that you just read to me the exact plot synopsis for God's Not Dead, and I had to every time I'll say it this way. Basically, what you just heard, folks, was not the synopsis for God's Not Dead, the film that is actually, you know, that's out yet.
Well, before I just read that entire thing, the beginning of that sentence that I just read is the film and Kohlberg's story both depict, and then...
Yeah. So, yeah. So those of you who have seen the film, what was just read was actually the synopsis for Rise.
Okay, those are all the similarities, but it also doubles as a detailed description of the movie.
Yeah, yeah. So that... Yeah, when the two similarities of two films, you know, also can describe what the film is, I think that they're...
In, like, really... in
really good detail.
Like, detail, yeah. That's just unbelievable. I mean, you have to think, like, the only way Kohlberg could lose this lawsuit is if she just has terrible lawyers along with really good lawyers from the God's Not Dead.
Well, and if...
Producers.
If there was some issue with the rights that she signed away, you know, but
yeah, from this information that we have, like she has to win, right?
Yeah.
Like, or at least get something. Maybe not the $100 million.
Well, okay, let's put it this way.
But I'm sure she's basing that $100 million on like how much money the movie made and how much did the money make in just the box office?
The first one?
Yeah, let's check. So I don't know. What are your thoughts while I'm looking that up?
You know, I mean, I don't know if I'm on the side of she should absolutely win.
You haven't
win.
Seen the movie, right?
I have not.
Right, because
I'm blessed.
Yeah. not quite blessed. because you haven't seen God's Not Dead.
Yeah,
that's you're a heretic.
That's completely. Yep.
Go away.
You hear the dogs rattling. Oh,
yeah,
around.
I don't know if you hear the dogs.
Yeah.
With their stupid nails on the hardwood. How do they get in our recording? Our very professional recording studio. That's what I want to know.
In Hollywood. No, but honestly, it's just like, I don't know if the original writer of, you know, Rise should win, but I just think that, you know, there's no way that you can refute that these two movies sound identical, you know. So it's not going to be
okay,
a
get
trial.
Get this. God's Not Dead was released in 780 theaters, which isn't a lot. It made $60.7 million. God's Not Dead 2 was released in 2,400 theaters versus the 780.
Yep.
So, like, more than three times mm-hmm. as many theaters. And it made one-third the grossing.
I mean, that's super interesting.
But only
honestly,
$2 million
like,
less on opening weekend.
What do you expect?
Anyway, so God's Not Dead 2 only made $20.7 million versus the $60.7 of God's Not Dead, the first one.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, well, that's...
Which is odd.
That's odd to you? The sequel makes less than the...
No, I mean so much less when you'd think everyone that went and paid money for God's Not Dead would be the kind of people that wanted to go see another one.
Yeah, you're right.
I can't really imagine a bunch of people being disappointed. Like, I don't know what they expected. Other than a movie that didn't look like it was made for TV. Like, even objectively from the plot line.
Yeah.
Or storyline.
I could see that.
Plot line? Can you say plot line?
No.
Or just storyline?
Storyline or plot?
Yeah. So the plot line was not good. Okay, so that's the last of the news. Which... was very overextended. We also talked about our favorite movies, and I also had a very lengthy
what
am I watching that isn't garbage.
I think at this point we're at like over an hour and 15 minutes, but I'll probably be cutting it down, so I don't know where
you're not cutting anything out.
Oh, we're not cutting anything out?
Not a single second. We're going to get my three attempts at that intro. We're going to get all of them.
Mm-hmm. Welcome to the...
Welcome.
What are we?
Yeah. So into the main event. Drum roll for this incredible film.
I can actually do a drum roll. I'll bring a drum next time.
Okay. Yeah. Do that.
You know, I'm gonna pause the recording and I'm gonna come back.
Catwoman, 2004. Right.
Yeah. 2004, starring Halle Berry.
Yeah, starring Halle Berry as the titular character. Can you hear that?
I really hope you guys can't hear. All right, so just a side note, guys. Andrew's dad is...
My stepdad.
Andrew's stepdad is currently...
He's a very loud exerciser, and he's exercising in just the other room. Yeah. Look, man, we're 18. give me some slack, okay?
We don't have a professional studio. Right now, we're in, like, just a living room.
You know what? Deal with it. Okay, so Catwoman, if you can even hear it, Catwoman 2004 stars Halle Berry as the titular character.
So
even though she was already Storm in the X-Men films. I don't know why she did this.
There's a lot of questions to be had, and we'll get into it. But
still ongoing as Storm. It wasn't like Chris Evans when he became Captain America, like 5 years after his franchise ended with Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
Like she was, like, and she still is Storm. In the middle of...
What? Okay.
Yeah, I don't know.
That's...
What was tempting about this film? She's a famous actress. This was like her prime, I think. I don't know.
I know that she felt shame of doing it after...
Yeah, which we'll get to. Okay, so it was directed by critically acclaimed, world-renowned, just... globally famous.
Oh yeah, you'll know the name.
Directed by Pitoff.
Oh, what's that? You don't actually know who that is?
Pitoff. That's his full name.
I don't know if that's I don't know if that's his full name.
It's really
but
his
rather,
only film.
But rather like the name that he wants to be like.
If it's call me. If you can even call this a real film.
It's real. I was just hoping that. All right, wasn't.
So this one, a few Razzies.
Just a few.
It won Worst Picture, Worst Actress, Worst Director, our boy Pitoff. And Worst Screenplay.
And fun story about the Worst
Actress.
Can
you imagine creating a film like that? Like, it's almost like. I wonder if Pitoff was like even trying to direct anything after that, or if he was just like in such shame that he created it.
I don't know how the entirety
of the film, you feel like he thinks he's so good at what he does.
Cause
like he thinks he's such a cool stylistic.
Everything
person.
Is very stylistic toward, you know, Pitoff. When I'm
awful.
Assuming Pitoff wanted
so
the style to
awful.
Be.
Now let's talk about the suit. Okay.
Oh man.
So this was. It's barely there, by the way. It's just like underwear with a few belts like across her stomach. Mm-hmm.
The pants are there, but I mean, it's just torn up.
Yeah.
Okay, I think the idea was that, oh, she's a cat, so her claws, which, by the way, she doesn't have claws. She doesn't have claws. So the claws will rip her own pants.
Yeah,
how sensible it is, you know.
And that hat... Her mask.
And we call it a hat for a good reason. It is not.
It's like.
It's
so highly raised above her head.
It is so tall.
It's so weird. It's like a. It's just like a dome
and
her head.
That's the weird part because it looks like the shape of a head. It looks like a skull, but it's just like. Her eyes.
Like,
are,
I don't know if it's just solid in there or if there's just like a bunch of air in between the top of her head and the. The inside of the
mask. I'm
going to
guess air, but, you know.
That'd be pretty funny.
Tell us who designed this beautiful costume.
Well, of course, it was designed by Academy Award-winning costume designer Angus Strathy.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know who, or, you know, what kind of things that she's, you know, what kind of portfolio that she has behind her, or had behind her at the time of making this atrocious costume, but.
It's awful.
It's really bad. But I just
mean, oh my gosh! Like, did you say her?
Did I say her?
That's a guy, Angus Strathy.
Did you also think it was a her?
Yeah, he was the costume designer for Deadpool, which is one of the best superhero costumes ever
okay,
adapted.
So what in the world happened here? Maybe
let's see what he won the.
Maybe
Oscar
Angus Strathy
for.
Just like knew it was going to be terrible.
I feel like I have to blame the director. Like,
yeah,
like even if he had a good design, it had to be agreed on with the director. Let's see. He won for... What? Moulin Rouge?
Moulin Rouge? Moulin Rouge.
Well, you just found out how white I am, everybody.
Yeah.
yeah, I guess. He won for that. He won the Oscar.
For what? Like the...
For costume design. That's all he does.
For Moulin Rouge. For... Yeah, that
for,
makes...
For Moulin Rouge, yeah.
Moulin Rouge. That makes a whole lot of sense, actually. I'm going to go plug in my computer for just a second because it's about to die. And
okay.
I haven't saved any of this.
I'm passing the time right now. What else do we have? Okay, so we mentioned before that it won a lot of Razzies.
We have nothing. That's it. Bye, guys.
One of which was Worst Actress, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Halle Berry is one of the few actresses or actors, or just anybody really, to like attend the Razzie ceremony.
Yeah.
The Golden Raspberry ceremony in person and accept her award on stage. Right? And she did so like with her Oscar
in hand. Yeah.
Yeah. So she was holding both.
And she was pretending to be sad, is that right?
Yeah, when I watched the video several months ago, she was like fake crying, like clearly flaunting her Oscar. Hold on one second.
So if I understand this correctly, like she was crying out of... Wait, why was she crying at the...
Well, she was pretending that she was really sad that she was poorly recognized. But like clearly showing off that she had a lot of accomplishments and it was
like
and you know like the Razzie people like they were clapping for her like they thought that was funny like they're not
yeah it's not
mad
just yeah it's not like a big
anything.
Like
right,
festival
it's
of
it's yeah it's
hatred.
Nothing like the Oscars. Because there's actually black people.
Oh boy. All right, let's get into that, right?
No, and here's what she said. She said, first of all, I want to thank Warner Brothers. I want to thank you for putting me in a piece of shit, god-awful movie. It was just what my career needed.
Yeah, so she...
That's a quote from Halle Berry.
I don't know if she knew it at the time of filming.
Could you imagine being Pitoff and your lead actress calls your film a piece of shit, god-awful movie?
Yeah. I mean, that's pretty low. And, I think it was deserved, but that's just like, you know... And you have to know what it's like to be working with to be in a film and work with a director. You get to know like people, right? Like she obviously got to know Pitoff, and I'm assuming was at least to some degree acquainted, you know, maybe friends with Pitoff. I don't like to say his name, but you know, and then like to go up there, you know, to go up there and be like this is just. And to just pan the film yourself and be like, hey, Mr. Director, friend, guy, acquaintance, I don't know. I don't know the relationship, but it's still like, you know, the hatred that she had for being in the situation completely trumped any, like, desire to keep...
You mean trumped? Completely
done.
Trumped any... Go ahead.
trumped any desire to keep the relationship of...
The Last Week Tonight reference.
Yeah. Yeah. Good show. But, you know, that's just pretty interesting.
Right. So, as we mentioned, she has won both an Oscar and a Razzie. And, Spencer, mm-hmm. I'm going to give you some trivia right here, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Halle Berry is one of six actors to win both a Razzie and an Oscar.
Actresses? Or, just, you know.
Actors can be applied to both. Now, I'm going to list nine actors and actresses. And I want you to tell me which five of those, since we already have... Halle Berry have won both a Razzie and an Oscar. Okay. Laurence Olivier, Jessica Walter, who was Lucille in Arrested Development, Liza Minnelli, who was Lucille 2 in Arrested Development.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Nicolas Cage, Kevin Costner, Sandra Bullock, Will Smith, Roberto Benigni, and Dustin Hoffman. So which five of those?
I'm going to guess right off the bat, Sandra Bullock.
Yes.
Yes, okay. Probably.
Which, she actually won those in the same year. She accepted her Razzie, and less than 24 hours later, got her Oscar.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to guess...
For All About Steve, and then The Blind Side was Oscar.
Liza Minnelli.
Okay. Yes, that's right.
Okay. Another guess is going to be Nick Cage.
Incorrect. You get three strikes. That's one.
Okay.
I'm making these rules up.
I don't know. Can I fail then if there's only three wrong answers?
I don't know. You have one more chance.
Okay.
And then you can still keep guessing, but I'm going to say that you failed the test.
Gotcha. Kevin Costner.
Correct.
So I got three now?
Yes. You have three out of the five.
I have not guessed Will Smith yet. I don't know if I want to guess Will Smith. Laurence Olivier?
That's correct.
Okay. Was one more?
Yeah.
My choices are, just so you guys are catching up, Jessica Walter.
Will Smith, Roberto Benigni,
and Dustin Hoffman.
One
of those is correct. Is that right?
Yes.
I'm going to guess Roberto Benigni.
That's right, of course.
Whoa.
Yeah. I mean, because I don't think I know who that is, so.
Okay, yeah, I got you.
You'd think the filler actors would be ones that I knew you would know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I tried to throw you off with Lucille 1 and 2 from Arrested Development.
Yeah. Were either of those? Who were they?
Jessica Walter and Liza Minnelli.
Oh, okay.
Liza Minnelli is the one that won the actress, the Oscar and the Razzie.
All right. Cool. That was the, that was cool.
All right. You passed. Congratulations, yeah. Spencer.
All right.
All right. So another piece of, another interesting fact. All the cats in the movie are real trained cats. There's no CGI. No, I'm joking.
Okay.
Obviously. Yeah. Obviously. It's, there might not be a real cat in the film, actually.
What?
No, there is. There
yeah,
is.
There's real cats.
But when they want the cats to, like, do things, mm-hmm. it's clearly, it's not even close.
It's so bad.
Speaking of the cats, what did you think the plot was? What's the plot?
Are you asking me right now? Are you asking me what the plot of the, of Catwoman?
Yeah.
2004?
What is the plot?
Okay, let's go.
There's
Patience,
like,
Phillips.
Patience Phillips.
By the way, guys, that's the name.
Okay, yeah. Selena Kyle is Catwoman in the comics. That's the only Catwoman. There's no other iterations.
No
There's
other.
Absolutely no reason to completely change her name for this one.
But
unless,
Pitov.
I mean, it is completely different from the comics. So maybe he just wanted to say, like, guys, this definitely is not the Catwoman you know.
Maybe.
In fact, her name is Patience Phillips.
Yeah, but that, anyway, that's the character that Halle Berry plays is going to be Patience Phillips. That's the lead.
She works for a beauty company?
You know, it's really unclear, but yeah, the company makes,
with, like, just completely over the top comical villains.
Mm-hmm. That's another thing.
Oh,
but
I think objectively,
where to begin?
I think the worst part of this entire film, like in one, like one aspect of it, not just mm-hmm. like scene, is the editing. I think probably by far, because it is just so unlike any like technique or reason within filmmaking.
In case you guys haven't seen clips from this film,
the infamous basketball scene.
The basketball scene is one of the best. I roughly counted the number of cuts cuts throughout
the clip.
Right,
you got an app where you could tap your phone and it would count.
That's right. And
in just like a 2 minute sequence of the basketball scene, maybe like a minute and a half.
A minute and a half, I think. 130-ish individual cuts throughout, what was it, like just a minute and a half. It's unbelievable. Like,
right. Okay, before we finish talking about
you can't pay attention.
The editing, let's continue with the plot.
Yeah, we'll get back to the editing there. And I highly suggest that you pause whatever you're listening to this on. Just pause it and go watch the basketball scene and in all of its glory. It is so...
Okay, so I had seen this film before. You had not. From what I remember, I remembered like the overall look of the film.
Mm-hmm.
And I remembered the scene where all the cats were crawling on her.
Yep.
I told you, like, this isn't going to be funny bad. Like, this is just going to be terrible bad. And boy, was I wrong.
Yeah. You didn't want to see the Catwoman. You had some other plans for other films, and we're not going to reveal it yet. But, you know,
maybe not by myself as much, but, like, with a friend. This movie is hilarious.
Oh, my gosh. It doesn't stop.
We watched it immediately after another terrible movie that was sort of trying to be bad, but this one wasn't, and it's far worse.
It is
far worse.
Yeah, it's far worse. There's no real words to describe how much of a failure Catwoman.
It's just in every aspect. I mean, it appeals to absolutely no one. So here's the plot. She Patience Phillips works for. She's kind of awkward and shy. Doesn't dress very well. You know, like a typical cat lady that doesn't own any cats. And she goes and she works at this makeup place that is like the makeup makes your face like plastic.
Basically,
indestructible.
The deal is
but
that
if you ever stop using it, your face like deteriorates into like burn victim like cracks and craters.
So which
is a horrible trade-off if you know it's going to happen because who cares if your face is indestructible?
Yeah.
Like, if you ever run out, you'll, like, your face will be permanently destroyed.
Yeah, they actually have.
And it's never made clear at all. And, like, what their goal is.
And keep in mind that Patience Phillips' job is just, she just sits at a desk, and really there's no, yeah. There's nothing that.
She sits next to a horrible, quirky, cute, fat friend, right? Yep. Yeah. And then this just incredibly over the top,
gay stereotype.
Flamboyant gay guy. Yeah.
Stereotype. Yeah. It's everything. It's so, the movie itself, we'll get into it, each individual aspect though, it's just so weirdly colored.
Oh, like, yeah. This high contrast and, like, yeah. Sort of, like, gleamy, like,
very
soft.
Very high contrast.
Yeah. And it's just shot ridiculously. It breaks all the rules of, like, shooting a scene.
You know,
and they use,
the classic, like, 180 degree.
Terrible one, early 2000s CGI to get these, like, physically impossible shots where the camera's just zooming through the city and, like, twirling, like,
yeah, they look okay, like, objectively looking at them, sure, they look nice, and there's nothing wrong with the CGI.
No, it's kind of,
I don't know, I don't think that there's anything, like, particularly, like, flawed with the CGI itself. It's just the fact that
for its time, I think now it would look much better.
Yeah, I think, but the whole aspect of... But
yeah, people forget that CGI is, like, supposed to look real.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's why you get this over-the-top garbage.
And then, like, the camera is, like, zooming through the city, even though that's not what ever would happen.
And then one day... Okay, back to the plot. One day, Patience Phillips is going to work. And by the way, at least two times in this movie, she only does things that she has no... reason to do when she's late for things.
Yeah.
Okay, so she's going to be late for work, and there's a cat up on an air conditioning unit outside of her apartment window, which is not hers.
So
and could be completely capable of leaving.
And keep in mind that at this point, you know, she's late to work, and she should just see the cat, and then, you know, a normal person would just leave, you know, walk out.
Oh yeah, there's a cat.
There's,
like,
a cat.
I'm sure it can get
near
down.
The apartment.
But she, like, she goes out onto her balcony very reluctantly for a cat she doesn't care about and shown no sign of, like, caring about cats in general.
And she's on the third floor.
No, she's on, like, the seventh floor.
Yeah, that's right.
Or something. She's pretty high up. And then she stands on that air conditioning unit after, like a different one to reach for the cat. And it's, like, breaking. And then that's when our hunk love interest.
Police officer.
Detective Lone sees her from
the street because somebody called in, like, a suicide,
or maybe I don't know. I think it might have been a coincidence, but then yeah, he thinks she's going to commit suicide, and the cat's gone, so he can't tell that that's what she was doing. And then the air conditioning unit's about to fall.
This is where
he runs up, like, every flight of stairs, gets into her locked door by somehow knowing which door it is in, like, less than 10 seconds.
I mean, no, it was like 5 seconds. So, like, from the point of it,
he runs up all the stairs, finds the room, breaks in, and catches her at the moment. Like, he's seeing her start to fall, and then he catches her, like, 7 stories up.
That's the next, almost the next cut is, like, him catching her.
Like, I can't imagine that anything would be cut out of that, right? Like, that had to be what it said in the script. Like,
and is there even, there's not even one cut, there's not even one shot of him,
you know,
running,
you don't see
upstairs.
Him running, yeah, yeah.
It's just, you
have no idea what he did.
Cut number he one is
teleported.
Him looking up. And
he might, because teleportation is not out of the question in this movie, evidently.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
Yeah. That sort of establishes that she likes cats. I don't know. And then what was she doing when she went to the place at night? What was her objective?
This movie's also,
she ended up in this place at night and found out about the terrible effects of the beauty place, and then she started getting chased by the cops, and they were just shooting at her relentlessly, shooting at this person, like, just going to kill her, these security guards. And then they just released all this water that inexplicably came out of nowhere. And then she, like, was going through... Oh, God. She was going through the sewer, and she was shot out. And it was this, like...
Oh, my God.
Oh, this cheesy slow-motion garbage.
There's so much bad about it.
And then she's in the water.
And she's dead.
Yeah, she's dead. Right, exactly. And then she gets dragged out of the water. And then when it shows her, she's like covered in like mud and stuff. Like as if she's been there for weeks.
She's like decaying.
She's not decaying.
Well, she looks like she's been
buried. Just looks like, yeah, just like she's been weathered over.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
And,
oh gosh.
And she, it just, it's unbelievable. Like, actually, oh, sorry, before this. Before this, like, okay, I swear there's no shot longer than 3 seconds, by the way. Before this, when she's at work, right? It's the same day as when he caught her. She's in work, right? And then he walks in, and she had told her cute, quirky friend about the guy.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then he walks in, and it's, like, supposed to... And the guy's, like, fine. Like, he's...
Yeah, he's fine.
He's, like...
He's there. He's in the makeup. Yeah,
he has a face.
At her job.
He has a face. That's how I can describe his attractiveness. I honestly, 1 through 10... In like my very highly regarded opinion of male attractiveness, like a 6,
I don't know. It's just like
5.
He's not handsome. He's just,
as we see by when he flashes his abs in the basketball scene, he is a fit guy.
Yeah, but it's not like a face that would actually like leave women like speechless.
Yeah,
as he does in these scenes.
I mean, Halle Berry is beautiful in the movie, but like no one cares about that.
Mm-hmm. It's so weird.
So the over the top gay guy calls him a man sandwich. It says like man sandwich alert or something like that.
Yeah.
And then he's like, the name's Detective Lone, or whatever. And then the quirky friend is like, Lone rhymes with cone, bone. And she's just like listing things that rhyme as she's walking away. And it's like someone typed that.
Yeah, into a script.
Yeah.
Oh. And that was what she was supposed to say.
Yeah.
As a joke or something. Or something.
Yeah. What kind of dialogue is that?
Who says that? What is the character that does that?
Yeah. So then later that night, I think maybe then she goes and then dies. And then the cats, these random cats, drag her out of the water.
Yeah.
And she looks weathered over. And then this horrible CGI cat.
Close up. It's like a...
Yeah, yeah. It's like a close up and it's like like a lion. Breathes into her mouth. Like goes on her chest. Breathes into her mouth. She comes back to life.
There's no cats anymore, by the way.
And you see her eye like do that thing that cat's eyes do where it's like
vertical.
Yeah, it's like a vertical, like slit the pupil.
The pupils, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It changes into that from a normal human.
Yeah, and pupil. Then it goes back to a circle after that.
Yep.
So that is a completely original thing. I'm almost positive in no interpretation of Catwoman has she been part cat.
Yeah, exactly. And I had not seen any iteration or any like I hadn't read anything about Catwoman before.
Well, you've seen The Dark Knight Rises, right?
I had, but I, yeah, yeah, and that's the part where I kind of knew about it. But like you said, Catwoman doesn't have any, you know, like direct cat.
Just like Batman didn't get breathed on by a bat when he was a child.
Yeah, Batman is not like, you know, he doesn't have like a little wing. That's like part bat.
And even like Spider-Man doesn't have weird spider impulses like by like sniffing catnip and
like, oh my goodness.
Oh, God.
This movie was so bad. Okay, guys, you gotta watch it. No, but yeah, so she's part cat in this movie. Thanks, Pita, for that. And she just.
Yeah, and, not explained.
And she doesn't.
We'll get to the part where it quote explains that. I'm furiously doing air quotes at Spencer right here.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm gouging his eyes out with my air quotes.
With your kitty claws.
Ah, that was Spencer.
Great.
Oh yeah, with my kitty claws. Okay, and
you guys are here for the comedy.
So she comes back to her house and she's all like, now she's like more confident, and then she like dresses better and.
Oh, and
the next
she jumps up to her like fourth
yes!
floor.
Yes.
And she has no idea. Like, how would she know that she can jump this high? And CGI is so awful.
And she's not surprised about it. She's like, she doesn't like.
Yeah, whoa. She jumps up onto her fire escape, right? Like a cat, on all fours. And she's just like, yep, that happened. Like, she's completely okay with it. She goes up to her apartment.
Acknowledge it at all.
And then there's this weird biker gang party, like across the window. Like in a different apartment building.
They're
playing pop music, but they're all these tough guys in a weird bar that's like raised.
In other words, it's a non-existent party. It has never happened before. In Pitov's mind, when he imagines partying teenagers, he thinks of a biker gang of like 30-year-olds.
We don't know what it's like in France, you know?
Yeah. I don't know. What do I know?
Yeah, what do you know, you idiot?
Oh, I'm very sorry.
You stupid piece of shit.
I'll stop the recording real quick.
Yeah, please.
I wonder if it's still recording. It's still recording.
Oh, okay, good.
What a pleasant surprise.
And then, gosh, what else? What else even happens in this movie? There's so many unnecessary scenes, which what I was about to get to is later in the movie, once she's all, you know, more confident with her powers, and she's a Halle Berry or whatever. She's Halle Berry confident. She's Halle Berry confident. Oh, that was a bad one.
That was so.
I honestly only did that because I mentioned puns earlier. That didn't come naturally. I'm sorry, guys. I sincerely apologize. Okay. Then there's this completely like 100% unnecessary scene. Where then she stands up and she's like, quiet down or whatever. And then she like runs into the bar and she's like grabbing the tap of beer and like spraying it on people.
Yep. That was after. Okay, you have to understand though. There's a scene before she becomes a Catwoman. There's a scene before that where she like yells across the balcony like, hey guys, quiet down.
Right.
At a different night, different party.
Yeah, different party.
Same room though. But like. And then she couldn't do anything about it. Like, oh.
So presumably a few of the same people at least.
Yeah, presumably. Then the second night, now she's all gritty and she's a Catwoman. So she goes back and she's like, I'm going to show them. So she jumps across buildings because, you know, cats. And then kicks down the door.
Yeah. Like, and then like surfs in on the door, right?
On
like
top
she
of
like
the
jumps
guy.
Onto the door and then it's like sliding across the room and she's on it.
You're thinking of the jewelry robbery. I think you are. Unless they pulled it twice, which...
No, I feel like I'm thinking the right thing and you're wrong, you idiot.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'm very sorry.
It's okay. I forgive you. So, and then she like stands up to him and the whole scene, so many scenes are so weird. There's a scene where they're walking...
No one really does anything about it.
This is before she's like Catwoman, when she's just like half cat, like before she gets like her costume and everything. She's walking with her quirky friend and then she like looks and she sees this jewel that she really wants, this necklace, and then her friend faints.
I forgot all about this. Okay, the quirky fat friend faints.
Yeah, just faints.
And I'm going to tell you right now, for no reason.
Absolutely no reason.
I mean...
Oh, it says it later, right? It says it way later. It says that it was because of the makeup and stuff, right? Yeah. I remember specifically that, like, it explained it way later. Anyway, so she just faints, and then she was in the hospital, and she's, like, talking about how much the doctors are, like, hunks or whatever, because she's that fat friend who's, like, sexually confident or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Okay, I hate that actress and the character.
Everything about it, really. Yeah, so she's in there. By the way, okay, whether or not it's explained, sure, it's explained later, and even though the reason is terrible, you know, it's a terrible movie, I don't care. It shouldn't have taken that long for the audience to have to sit through, you know, like, just waiting for an explanation. Because we sat there on his couch, and we're like, why is she fainted? Why is she on the floor? We sat there through the whole movie and not understanding why she was in the hospital. And she just stayed there. And she... deliberately, like, one of her lines stated that she was deliberately faking keeping ill so that she could be with the man-hung doctors. I'm serious.
Oh my god. Okay. Oh, there's that horrible shot where it's like locked in front of her as she's running around the jewelry store. You know, she's running on the wall.
Oh.
The camera's like staying in front of her face, and it's just like, everything looks so bad. It never looks like a human being is moving around.
Yeah, so the scene where she is at first, I thought that she was, like, saving the day, you know, from... There were already robbers.
Yeah, well, that's sort of the idea of Catwoman.
Yeah, yeah, I get like that now. Anti-hero. Yeah, yeah. But there were already, like, thieves, or, like, robbing the bank. They were smashing glass and stuff, grabbing things. And the camera pans
to her. Oh, my gosh, and it's so funny. These guys are, like, being relatively, like, stealthy. Yeah. Right? And then he just starts automatic rifle, just firing away at this lady.
Both of them.
Just destroying
the shotguns. Both of them have shotguns. And they aim up to where the camera panned to her, and she's like, amateurs. She says it out loud. So any, you know, trying to stay undercover was destroyed at that point. But she says amateurs, and then, what does she say? It wouldn't it be just perfect?
Something like that.
She's referring to, like, if they got away, but, like, she says perfect, and they put it in the script of her saying P-U-R-R-R, ficked.
What, it would have been really funny if both of those, like, burglars just bursted out laughing.
That would have been good. That would have been actually good, but of course they didn't.
Like, what the hell? Like,
what? No, but they look at each other. They look at each other confidently. Both of them aim upwards with their shotguns, and they start firing at the glass, at her.
Yeah.
Repeatedly. They deplete their ammo supply blindly.
Mm-hmm.
Because she's gone at that point.
There's also a sort of infamous scene in which she goes to return the cat that saved her life, and this really weird... Like, like maybe blind? I think she had, like, weird contacts in.
Nothing matters. It doesn't matter.
Like, cat lady, she's like, come in. She's like, oh, I'm going to be late. It's like, you don't have to come in then. Just drop the cat off and leave. But she, like, walks in. And then, like, it's, like, sort of implied that, like, she knows that, like, since she was saved by the cat, she knows that she's a cat woman. A cat woman, yes. Because the explanation for how she brought it back to life and what the hell is going on with her being half cat is, like, she basically just throws a bunch of pictures of, like, Egyptian drawings of cat people, and she's like, cat women have been around for millions of years, never been bound by the rules.
I don't know. It's like the movie was bad enough already before they tried to, like, stick a bunch of lore and, like, you know, backstory, Egyptian, like, backstory in it. And then it's just so...
But the first time she goes to her house, she, like, throws patience, like a ball of catnip, and...
Oh.
Halle Berry's just like rubbing it all over her face, and she's just like,
I mean, obviously the look is,
and like stopping and like going again. She's like,
it's like involuntarily. It's of course, but
yeah, it's unbelievable. The idea, but and then like she takes it away from her, and she kind of like leans her head forward, like she still wanted to smell it. Oh, it's
really bad.
I can't believe it. It's okay, really, so let's really, skip really ahead bad. To like what someone would consider the climax of this story, where she's in the mansion. Of one of, like, the wife of the guy who runs the evil company that she works for.
Mm-hmm.
And she goes up to this blonde lady. Sharon Stone, by the way. Here's an interesting fact about Sharon Stone. Sharon Stone, in the middle of filming a scene, her cell phone rang, and she answered it. How little do you have to care about the film and the career that you're working? Everyone, films take a lot, like the lighting to get set up and like everything. And she has her cell phone. It rings like from someone, and she answered it. She answers it, and she like held up the filming for some time. And by the way, going back to what you said about the perfect, I can't purr. Go ahead and do it again.
Do I have to do it again?
Yes, you do.
Okay, I'll do it again. The perfect.
Yeah, that was close enough. Okay.
Not close enough.
Speaking of cat puns, the film was originally planned to be released in IMAX format, but Warner Bros. Ended up canceling that because the visual effects delays on the movie, which were rightly delayed because, you know, it ended up being a really good product, the visual effects. I thought they were fantastic and revolutionary. did not give IMAX enough time to remaster the film.
You're right.
And the promotional title, Catwoman, Catwoman, the IMAX experience, was going to be used along with the tagline, Cat-sure in IMAX.
Catcher.
That's capital C-A-T, lowercase C-H, her in IMAX. And that was going to be put on posters.
So this Catcher. This is what the
and
people...
And it's like a dark movie.
This is what the people of 2004 would be looking at when they drive down, like, and they would see billboards. Catch her.
Catch her in IMAX.
In IMAX. I don't even know. I just...
Oh, man. Could you imagine seeing this film on an IMAX theater? An IMAX screen.
IMAX. It looked awful.
Speaking of interesting IMAX, just for an interesting fact about a good movie, just because I was reminded of it. Did you know that there were only 4 IMAX cameras in the world at the time of filming The Dark Knight? Which I just realized sounds kind of weird since this came out in 2004, but but I'm piecing together evidence, and that means they must have remastered it. They didn't actually film it. In the same way that they used to remaster stuff in 3D, but now they film it in 3D. Anyway, so there were only 4 IMAX cameras in the world at the time of filming The Dark Knight, and Christopher Nolan broke one of them. Like smashed it in the chase scene under the tunnel where Joker's in the semi truck and there's the garbage truck and they're transporting Harvey Dent. He smashed it in between two cars.
He smashed it. I mean, I'm guessing unintentionally.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And the IMAX cameras were also really loud, so a lot of the scenes had to be like ADR, and that's incredible to me. ADR is such a difficult process, and they have people who specialize in it. Do you know what that is?
Mm-mm.
That's where they have to redub all of the dialogue and sound effects for a scene. If it's done horribly, it's so obvious.
Yeah.
If you watch The Room, so much of that is ADR.
Isn't it all? It's not all ADR, is it?
I don't know, but like that opening, the whole opening scene. Which is a fantastic scene in The Dark Knight. I can't. Why are
not
we talking
The Room?
About,
don't.
Which is a fantastic opening scene in The Dark Knight. Like that's all ADR, but it's so, like, it's incredible. Anyway, so back to back to the good stuff.
Yeah. The quality film right here.
So there's a line in this film. when they're in that mansion in the potential climax of the film, I wouldn't really. I don't think this film really has a plot or any structure. She says to Sharon Stone, Catwoman says to Sharon Stone, "Tell me where your husband is, or I'll ask him myself."
Yeah, so obviously right off the bat, we have a few problems with, you know, what this means.
Or how it's possible. Is it a threat?
Yeah.
Or I'll ask him myself.
Is it a clever...
Okay, well, then you would have found him. And
yeah, then you wouldn't ask him where he is. Hey, where are
that's
you?
That's one of the worst lines I've ever heard.
It's unimaginable.
Because, like, a lot of them are, like, the perfect... Like, that's stupid. But at least it makes sense.
Yeah.
Right? Like, as soon as you write, or I'll ask him myself, how do you not think, like,
immediately?
Oh, what?
How do you mess up to that degree? Tell me where your husband is, or I will ask him myself.
What? You clearly have established that you cannot find him.
Yeah.
Oh my god. Okay.
And even if that was possible that you could ask him, is that a threat? Is that a problem? I will ask him. Like, oh, then ask him. Is that a danger? Is there something? I don't know.
And then, like, oh, the handwriting scene.
The what?
The handwriting scene.
I feel like it's gonna click with me, and then...
That they get the advanced computers and scientists to debunk, to match the handwriting on two things. And she's like, well, see, this one looks like it was written by a woman. Like, or no, she deduces the personalities of the people based on how they write, like, letters. And it's clearly, it's the same word written twice, and it's clearly the same handwriting, but they get this, like, advanced scientist, and he's like, and it's sort of, like, meant to establish that, like, Catwoman and Patience Phillips are different people, like, you know, like, it's like...
That was the idea, yeah.
Like, at one point she says, like, I didn't do it, Catwoman did it,
or
whatever.
It took some deep insight to figure that out, by the way, guys, but, like, that's what the idea was.
And it was
Pitoff
just,
had.
As soon as he said, like, you... Like, no one believes what this guy's saying. Like, oh, yeah, see, the way she, like, fiercely, like, lined her why. It's like she must be, like...
Yeah, yeah. The idea was, the first one was Patience Phillips. And then this one was Catwoman because it's edgier and more...
Yeah, ooh, edgy.
And that was supposed to be a plot development without That was like him creatively saying something about the character, but it just doesn't go over as well as he wanted it to.
I don't really know what he was thinking.
I don't know what happened with this whole movie at all.
Yeah, this it's
a mistake.
Okay, I usually maintain that Batman and Robin is the worst superhero movie of all time, but I think this one is probably worse. Yeah. After a rewatch,
we're gonna have to do Batman and Robin for an episode.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
I think I haven't seen it. That's enough of a reason right there to watch it in the first place. But in case you don't know. I know you don't know. Andrew's least favorite superhero film up to this point, but I guess before watching Catwoman.
Rewatching.
Always been Batman and Robin from, what was that year, 1998?
1997, the year I was born.
Yeah, it's awful.
Did they get like a guy with Tourette's to edit this film?
Like, I don't know. And by the way, I was talking about the basketball scene earlier, guys, but that's basically the whole film. It's just cut, like constantly.
Yeah,
you cannot pay attention.
Even when it's not going back and forth, there's a scene where this guy's talking and it's cutting in the middle of his sentences.
Yeah.
Like to different angles.
Here's what he says.
Barely different angles.
Here's what he says. Here's this whole line. The whole line is, we will distribute the medicine and they will, and whenever they put it on their face, it will destroy them. I don't care about the people. I care about the money. All right. Now that's the whole line. It was distributed through different weird camera angles and like eight different shots, that one line. And it was weird because it was different shots. Like it was different, like, and action. It was different cuts. So you could hear like his inflection changing with each cut. So it sounded like, I don't care about the money. It was like, it was so bad.
Remember the Ferris wheel scene?
I do remember the Ferris wheel
scene.
How many scenes are in this movie?
How many scenes that could not be, that didn't need to be in this movie? It's only an hour and a half. Like, and there's so much
fluff. I will say, this movie is entertaining from start to finish. I'll give it that. Not in any way that it meant to be, but, you know, there's really not a lull ever in the movie. It's always just, something is happening, and it's always insane.
It's okay. Yeah, they're like in a Ferris wheel, and then it gets stuck at the top, and like it just starts malfunctioning like incredibly.
Oh yeah, yeah. They
like,
have CGI.
Like shaking.
They have CGI like, gears that are
the guy's
separating.
Like, oh.
They're separating. The gears are separating.
And then like they both, like Detective Lone and Catwoman, like are both like running down and like saving people.
Well, and then both they just them? Wait. Both of them?
Yeah, I think so. Detective Lone like jumps out too.
I don't think so.
I'm pretty sure he does.
I thought Catwoman is the only Catwoman. Patience jumps out of. Yeah, she's not in. Obviously,
no. I remember. I'm pretty sure he's like hanging from it at one point, like intentionally trying to get lower, like closer to the center.
Hmm. Well, you're wrong.
Oh. Okay. Well, and then I mean that's just one of the many like terrible scenes. Yeah. I'm so glad this movie was only an hour and a half.
Yeah, I don't know how I could have handled any longer, honestly. But yeah, that's Catwoman. Is there any more points that we had on the board?
No, I didn't have anything.
Keep in mind, there is much more that we could be talking about, but we're breaking it on 2 hours here. So,
what would you rate the film?
All right, so for those of you who are new to the show,
which is every single
one of you,
yeah.
As this is episode one, we're going to be doing a rating system for each terrible movie that we watch. It's going to be a trash bag out of trash bags, right? A trash bag out of five.
I would give it five trash bags out of five trash bags.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah, explain to me why you think it's going to be five out of five. Worst, like, that's...
Does that... I mean, a star is a good thing. Trash bag's a bad thing.
That's right.
If we're doing five out of five trash bags, I mean, that's like the most trash you can have.
I mean, this movie was terrible, but...
I'm going to say five out of five trash bags. What do you think?
I'm going to give it four and a half trash bags out of five trash bags.
Okay.
Just because half of it is I don't want to expend my five trash bags out of five.
So five trash bags you think is just unbearable?
Five trash bags.
This was fun.
I think if I rate anything five trash bags, I think that'll be my least favorite movie. That's That's it. I think, or anything I rate by.
Are you telling me that you've seen a worse film?
That I've seen a worse film than Catwoman?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What?
I mean, it depends on whether or not you count So Good It's Bad. Like Birdemic. Have you seen Birdemic?
No.
The Room.
Yeah, The Room's amazing though.
Exactly. Like it's hard. It's hard to like really.
I love that room.
I don't want to. And also, Catwoman was so entertaining.
Moon. We both love Moon.
Yeah,
that's another film we both love.
Underground.
Underground film 19. Underground gem. Hidden gem. Hidden gem. 1994.
Hidden underground gem.
Yeah.
1994 Moon. That's not the year it came out. 2009. That's a Reddit.
We both love Mad Max Fury Road, of course.
Okay, I'll give it 4.5.
Sorry, that was going way back to the beginning of the episode.
Four and a half trash bags out of five trash bags for Catwoman on my front here. This movie was terrible. It was so bad. It was very, very bad. It's not a movie that is so bad that I wouldn't recommend it though. As a lot of the films that we will, in the future, you know, take a look at, I probably will not recommend a lot of those. This movie though, watch it. It's hilarious. What do you think?
Definitely 5 out of 5 trash bags.
Do you recommend it though?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's funny. It's so funny.
Yeah, I recommend it to people who love Catwoman. I recommend it to people.
No.
I recommend it to people who love like long takes, like The Lobster.
Yeah. Or, really, you know, really
like the Western films.
Definitely.
Yeah. So Spencer, I gotta ask you, completely unrelated to the film.
Mm-hmm.
Does anything grind your gears that you just want to vent about? You just want to rant about? This is a section, by the way, where we're. After we talk about the film, we're going to talk about something that happened to us or something that happens to us and, that we just hate. And we're going to rant about it. And I had the idea right before the episode to call it Rants In My Pants. And I would said that jokingly, but Spencer said he kind of likes it.
Yeah, we'll call it Rants In My Pants.
Okay, Rants In My Pants.
I actually like it. So
Rants.
Welcome to the segment Rants In My Pants, where we talk about things that, you know, are pretty vexing that we currently, you know, is on our mind of hatred. And, you know, since it was a pretty late in production idea, I've been busy with setting up the, you know, the recording station, so.
And I was asking Spencer how he can believe, I mean, how it's possible that he's just not constantly thinking about the things that he hates the most.
Yeah, because I can't think of anything. I still can't think of a single thing.
Because that's something that's constantly on my mind, absolutely, is just the worst things about my life.
Bubbling hatred.
Yes. Constantly boiling inside
me. So yeah, for this first episode, guys, I unfortunately am not going to have a rant in my pants. But what do you got, Andrew?
No rants in your pants, eh?
Nothing.
So this is something that happened to me recently. Now, I'm sure many of you know about the dating app Tinder. I am a member of Timber. I'm yelling Timber.
Oh, wow. I wasn't going to cut it, but I don't know about now, man.
I am a member of Timber, and...
As am I.
Wow, loser. And I got a notification that I got a super like, right?
Which, for those of you who don't know the app, it's just like it...
It's just something that, like, normally you just like them, and then if they like you, then you know. But a super like tells you that they like them, and then you only get one a day.
One a day. Try to conserve it as best you can.
People don't normally use it, and a lot of people say, like, in their bio, like, if I super liked you, it was probably an accident or something like that.
Yeah, something like that, because it's embarrassing to, especially embarrassing if you actually accidentally super like.
I actually did that yesterday, yeah. Wow. Accidentally super like. I don't think they've.
Oh, gosh.
Anyway, the point is, okay, so this girl's name was Emily. She's 18, like 3 miles away, right?
Of course.
You know, she was kind of cute. She wasn't like incredible, but she super liked me and she was pretty cute. So I liked her back. You know, she started talking to me and she asked like if the camera in the picture that I, my main picture, I'm holding my DSLR, which mm-hmm. is a Canon T5. She's like, is that a Canon T5? And I was like, oh yeah, I'm impressed. And I was like, do you have a Canon? Yeah. And,
this is not cool.
And
so not cool.
And, like, you know, the conversation was just kind of normal.
you know, I asked like, oh, what are some of your favorite movies? It was a pretty normal conversation. Most of it was like me asking her and then,
yeah,
I mean, sorry, me replying to her and then me saying like, what about you? Like that seemed like a lot of it was like that. Okay, it wasn't a very long conversation. Yeah. Then the next day after that, you know, she messages me like, hey, at like 4 p.m. And then I was like, hey, what's up? And she's like chilling in the tub with my bath bombs or whatever. And I was like, oh, that sounds relaxing. And she was like, there's room for two. And then I was like, oh, this is going somewhere quickly.
Yeah. What the heck?
And then and she asked what I was doing. And I told her like I was like researching time travel and fiction. Because like I said, I'm developing a film about time travel.
Yeah.
Wait, did you mention that in the
podcast? Yeah.
Okay.
Right when I was talking about Primer.
That's right, yeah.
And it just sort of escalates from there into, like, her saying, like, what would you do to me? And then...
Great.
Yeah. And then...
It really went this far?
Yeah. And then I like, we talked.
Yeah.
And she, like, went... Like this was really fast, and I was just like, this is odd. Like, why is this happening?
I would be
so
pissed.
And then she said something very specific and in all caps, that only I would know.
Oh yeah,
and only me and two other people.
Specifically
two of my best friends. And I immediately replied with, that was elaborate and weird. And then it was right before I was going to eat dinner. So I actually turned off my phone because they started calling me on Snapchat a bunch, like video calling me. And so I just turned off my phone and then I ate dinner. And then when I turned it back on, there was all these apologies over texts because they thought like I was just, they were like, oh, sorry if that was too far. I'm not going to name them, but Kevin and Josh were like telling me like, okay, Kevin was a little bit more apologetic. He was very condescending about it. I don't think he was trying to be condescending. Josh was like trying to take the high road on it. And they both clearly don't understand what's wrong with it. I like asked them questions. I was like, why do you guys think this is funny? Like you weren't like, I'm so glad they didn't do this, but what would have been funny is if they like said some really weird things and to see if I like to see how my reaction was, but they just pretended to be a girl.
Okay. I'm really glad that they didn't do that. That would have been like,
yeah, that would have been like, horrible. That would have been cruel. Yeah. But like, this is just not funny. Like,
yeah.
Like I don't get it. Like for me, their end, like if I were on their end, I would have been like, why did you guys go through so much effort just to do something and then immediately apologize for it?
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah,
the immediate apology thing.
But it was just, yeah, it was just weird. And it was, and I was like asking, like, you were the one instigating most of the conversation. So it was like, were you just trying to prove something? Like, mm-hmm. if you went really, like, quickly into, like, intimate things to see how I would react? Like, I don't understand what the point of this is or what the humor is in it if you're not doing things that are ridiculous.
Yeah, that's the weird part.
It's
like you would think.
I forgive them for it. I still don't understand it at all, and it upsets me that they would do that. But like I'm not gonna argue with them about it. I just said okay to both of them and went on with it.
It's weird because like if it was a joke and they were trying to get like a weird like quirky and just a funny reaction out of it, right? They would it would be like all mostly weird stuff, right?
Yeah,
but it was like what I'm getting from you is just them pretending to be a female.
Yes, that's exactly. That's where I don't see the humor in it, and it's something that's my little rant about it. It's a very reserved rant. Mm-hmm. I did do a lot of ranting in my head, and this event is actually the reason that I wanted to introduce the segment on the podcast.
Rants in My Pants.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but so like that's my main concern with it is I just don't think it's funny like objectively, and they could have made it funny, but I'm glad they didn't.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't understand like the and also how condescending, specifically Kevin. Once again, I'm not gonna name names, but specifically Kevin Meadows, he was like, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't want it to escalate that much or whatever. And I was just thinking, like, you had complete control over that.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because everything I was doing was in response to what you were doing.
It wasn't really a mistake, like that.
Right. And then he said, like, keep on Tindering, brother. And I thought that was the most condescending statement. Like, thanks for the permission, you arrogant shit.
That is like, yeah, that might be the worst part, is actually like
oh, think,
because like, he's the girlfriend, right?
Yeah, and he thinks he's like in his mind, I was like discouraged from like continuing to do it, like because of what he did. Like he thinks like he had so much impact. Like it's just the whole thing. I don't know. Like, nothing about the event I am okay with, but I forgive them, like, because they're my best friends, and I don't really care. And they stopped talking about it, so it's okay.
Yeah. Yeah, it's always frustrating, though, like, when your best friends are, like, when they try to do something that, like, in their head is like, oh, it's just an impulsive thing.
But like, and I keep thinking, but it's not impulsive. They had to go through so many steps, because exactly. Tinder is through Facebook, so they had to make a fake Facebook. Or they had to log into someone that they know is Facebook, who I don't know because I do not recognize this person. Or so they either made a Facebook, uploaded a bunch of pictures of someone that I do not know, and then like made the bio, just searched and searched for me, going through all these guys, and then finally really super liked me. Yeah, like
that's oh yeah, they had to search for you.
Yes.
What?
Exactly. They couldn't just like search my name.
This is so, like,
detailed. I know. Like, I asked them, like, how did you go through all these steps without thinking this was weird?
What?
Anyway, that's the rant that came from my pants today.
So, well, yeah, just expect next time, guys. That's kind of like the style of rant that I will hopefully have at that point. I just couldn't think of anything specifically. Usually, we're going to try to keep them off topic from specific movies, but... Yeah,
Spencer, where can they find us?
You guys can email us at worstpodever@gmail.com. Give us some feedback.
You can find me at Android Rhyme on Twitter and Instagram.
And I'll be on Instagram at Valor Parlor. And, you know, just, I don't know. The spelling is weird. The Valor part is the European spelling.
We'll put it in some kind of description.
VALOUR, and then Parlor is American spelling with just the OR.
We're never respelling it, so I hope you.
Yeah,
I hope you.
Yeah, we're not gonna. That was it. That was your one.
We
time.
Just have like hundreds episode of fans one. Already, uh-huh. Despite literally no one knowing that this podcast exists.
That's right.
That it doesn't know us.
Uh huh. All right. Well, to all none of you so far. Thanks for listening.
Yeah. Bye. Wait. What should we say? Should we have a sign off like catchphrase?
I don't know. I think what we said was fine.
Okay.